chapter 2, verses 14 through 24, verses 14 through 21. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, Men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken, as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesize, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesize. And I will show wonders in heaven above, and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before that great and notable day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Burkett notes, observe here the holy courage of St. Peter in defending the innocency of the apostles and confuting the calumny of drunkenness which was now cast upon himself and them. These men are not drunken, as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day, where note, 1, how he argues negatively from the time of day. It was but the third hour of the day, that is, 9 o'clock in the morning, which was the hour for the morning sacrifice and prayer. And the worshippers of God, at the great feast especially, were never wont to eat and drink before those holy services were performed. In those times they went to their public devotions fasting. They served God before they served their bellies. The first fruits of the day were offered in the temple then, in the tavern now. 10 morning and evening visits are made by some to the latter, for 1 to the former. Note farther how he argues positively. He assures them that the apostles were full of the Holy Ghost, and not full of wine, filled with the Spirit of God, and that what was now done was the completion of a prophecy uttered by Joel, that in the last days, that is, in the days of the Messiah, there should be a most plentiful fusion of the Holy Spirit upon all flesh, that is, upon Jews and Gentiles, and upon all sorts of persons, without distinction, old and young, sons and daughters, bond and free. Learn thence that the Spirit of God is a free spirit, not confined to any party, not to any order of degrees of men, but plentifully and abundantly poured forth under the gospel dispensation upon all believers. It is one of the great cheats which the Pope has imposed upon the world to persuade them to believe the Spirit of God is tied to the pommel of his chair, that he and his cardinals have monopolized the Holy Ghost. But blessed be God, he has promised to pour out his Spirit upon all flesh, even upon servants and handmaids, to show that he doth not despise persons of the lowest ranks and conditions in this world, but that the promise of the Spirit is made unto them also. Observe lastly, what is here foretold that should come to pass after the great effusion of the Holy Spirit, namely, wonder in the heaven and signs in the earth, the sun turned into darkness and the moon into blood, which expressions signify the great miseries and troubles, the calamities and desolations, which should befall the Jews before the destruction of Jerusalem, for their crucifying the Lord of life and glory, unto which is subjoined the only way to escape and avoid them, namely, calling upon the Lord in fervent prayer and supplication. Whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Intimating that prayer makes us shot free, and is a sure defense in all storms, that no evil shall fatally touch our persons or come near our dwellings, while we take hold of God by faith and approach unto him by prayer. Lord, how happy is it when strong afflictions from thee raise strong affections in us towards thee. Verses 22 through 24. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs which God did by him in the midst of you, and as ye yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it. Burkett notes, St. Peter, having wiped off the unjust aspersions of drunkenness cast upon himself and his brethren in the foregoing verses. In these, he makes it his business to convince the Jews that they were the murderers of the best man that ever lived in the world, even Jesus of Nazareth, the true and promised Messiah. In order to this, he treats in the sermon, 1, of the person and life of Christ, 2, of the suffering and death of Christ, 3, of the resurrection of him from the grave. First, as touching his person, the apostle shows that he was evidently sent from God and approved of him by those many miracles, wonders, and signs which were wrought by him. Hence note that the many and great miracles wrought by Christ evidently proved that he was sent of God and came from him and was approved by him. Our Savior's miracles, for the nature of them, were beneficial to mankind. For the number of them, they were many. For the manner of their operation, they were public and open, in the sight and view of all the people, not in corners like the popish miracles, wrought before their own creatures only, but before his enemies. And for the quality of them, they were of the greatest magnitude, cleansing the lepers, raising the dead, giving sight to them that were born blind, by a word spoken, by a touch given, so that our blessed Savior had all the attestations that miracles can give, that he was commissioned by God and came from God. The second part of Peter's sermon here treats of the suffering and death of Christ. By wicked hands ye have crucified and slain him, who was delivered by the determinate counsel of God. Where note 1, the name and kind of death which Christ died. This is described more generally. It was a violent death. Ye have slain him. More particularly, it was an ignominious, cursed, and dishonorable death. Ye have crucified him. Learn thence that the Lord Jesus Christ was not only put to death, but to the worst of deaths, even the death of the cross. Now the death of the cross was a violent death, a painful death, a shameful death, a lingering death, a succorless death, and a cursed death. Note 2, the causes of Christ's death are here expressed. The principal cause, permitting and ordering, was the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. The instrumental cause, affecting, was the wicked hand of the Jews. Him being delivered by the determinate counsel, etc., ye have taken and by wicked hands crucified, etc. Learn hence that there was not any one particular action or single circumstance relating to the death of Christ, but what came under the holy counsel and wise determination of God. Yet this foreknowledge and counsel of God, as it did not necessitate and enforce them to it, so neither doth it excuse them in it. God's foreknowledge and determinate counsel did no more compel or force their wicked hands to do what they did than the mariners hoisting up of his sails to take the wind to serve his design can be said to compel the wind to blow. God's end in acting was one. Their end in acting was another. His most pure and holy, theirs most malicious and daringly wicked. In respect of God, Christ's death was justice and mercy. In respect of man, it was murder and cruelty. In respect to himself, it was obedience and humility. The third part of the apostle's sermon respects the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ from the grave. Verse 25, whom God hath raised up, having loosened the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it. Christ, though laid, was not lost in the grave, but revived and rose again, and rose by the power of his Godhead. True, God is here said to raise him, and the Spirit elsewhere, but we are not to understand it so, as if they raised him by their own power, without his own power. For he declares it expressly, John 2, in 3 days I will raise up the temple of my body. And if he had not raised himself up by his own power, how could he be said, Romans 1, 4, to be declared to be the Son of God by the resurrection from the dead? What more had appeared in Christ's resurrection than any other, if that were all? For others were raised by the power of God as well as he. Now because the Jews, to whom Peter here preaches, were filled with prejudice against Christ, the apostle thought fit to tell them that God had raised him from the dead. Yet by consequence, it sufficiently appears in the following discourse that Christ raised himself from the dead. Learn thence that the Lord Jesus Christ, by the omnipotent power of the Godhead, his Father's, the Spirit's, and his own Godhead, revived and rose again from the dead, to the terror and consternation of his enemies, and the unspeakable consolation of all believers. As by the eternal Spirit, or by the power of his own Godhead, he offered up himself to God when he died, so when he was put to death in the flesh, he was quickened by the Spirit, that is, by the power of his divine nature. The same Spirit enabled him to do both. Observe also the reason annexed why God raised up Jesus Christ, because it was impossible that death should hold him. But how impossible? 1. 'Twas naturally impossible, upon the account of that divine power which was inherent in his person as God. 2. 'Twas legally impossible, because divine justice, being fully satisfied by his sufferings, required that he should be raised to life, as when a debt is paid, the prisoner is discharged, and the prison door opened. Verses 25 through 35. For David speaketh concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face. He is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover also, my flesh shall rest in hope, because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou hast made known to me the way of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulchre is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him, that of the fruit of his loins according to the flesh, he would rise up Christ to sit on his throne. He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. This Jesus has God risen up, whereof we are all witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this, which ye now see and hear. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand, until I make thy foes thy footstool. Burkett notes, Peter here proceeds in this memorable sermon, which he preached at the Feast of Pentecost, to convince the Jews that Jesus, whom they had crucified, was undoubtedly the promised Messiah, because he was raised from the grave according to the prophetical prediction, Psalm 16, Thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither will thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. And accordingly, St. Peter doth strongly prove that these words, in their literal sense, could not be spoken of David, because he was left in the grave and saw corruption, but must be applied unto Christ, who though he was laid, yet was not lost in the grave, but saw no corruption, being raised by God the third day. Hence note that though death bound the hands and feet of Jesus Christ and laid him in his grave, yet, Samson-like, he snapped and broke those bands asunder, it being impossible that he should be holden of them or confined by them. It was impossible for Christ to continue death's prisoner in the grave longer than 3 days. 1. Because he was Lord of life and death. He was the resurrection and the life. Life to quicken himself, and the resurrection to raise us. He was the resurrection effectively, the life essentially and formally. Now it was impossible for death to hold him that was life itself under its power any longer than he who is life pleased. And for this reason he is said to swallow up death in victory, 1 Corinthians 15:54. 2. Because of his undertaking for us. For if Christ had been held by corporal death, we must have continued forever under the power of spiritual death. Therefore, the Holy One was not suffered to see corruption, the least corruption, according to the prophetical prediction, Psalm 16, Thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, that is, my dead body in the grave. For David was left in that hell from which Christ was raised, but the hell which David was in was not beyond the grave. Nor suffered thy Holy One to see corruption, that is, I shall neither see nor feel nor lie under the power of corruption, but shall suddenly rise again, and then my Father will show me the path of life and make me full of joy with his countenance. That is, after my resurrection, I shall live forever in glory in the presence of my Father, where I shall have fullness of joy and rivers of pleasure forevermore. The last part of St. Peter's sermon treats of Christ's ascension. Verse 33. Therefore, being at the right hand of God exalted, etc., intimating that when the Lord Jesus Christ had finished his work upon earth, he was placed in the seat of the highest honor and authority at the right hand of God in heaven. To convince the Jews of the certainty hereof, St. Peter applies that promise, Psalms 110:1, unto Christ. Sit thou on my right hand until I make thy foes thy footstool. Showing that these words are not applicable unto David, for David is not ascended into heaven in his own person, but his body remained in the sepulchre then amongst them. But Christ was ascended, and at the right hand of God exalted, and pursuant to his promise, had now sent down the Holy Ghost in fiery cloven tongues and diverse languages upon them. Where note the great and wonderful change in the state and condition of Christ since his ascension into heaven. A little while since they called him the carpenter's son, this fellow, this deceiver. Now he has obtained a more excellent name than angels. Then he had not a place to lay his head on. Now he is exalted to be the heir of all things. Here he sweats, there he sits. Here he groaned, there he triumphs. Never to groan, weep, or bleed more. His human nature is now advanced to the highest honors, even to the object of adoration both to angels and men. This was the doctrinal part of St. Peter's sermon. It treated of the person, life, miracles, death, resurrection, and ascension of the Lord Jesus in a very close and convincing manner. His warm application of the whole follows, verse 36. Verse 36. Therefore, let all of the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Burkett notes, that is, God the Father hath ordained and appointed this Jesus, whom ye have crucified, to be the head and Savior of his church, he being the true and promised Messiah. Learn hence that the Lord Jesus Christ was constituted and appointed by his Father to be the supreme governor and only Savior of his church. God had made Jesus both Lord and Christ, both a prince and a savior. Note farther how very close and home the apostle is in applying what he had said to his auditors. He that doth not rest in generals, but says plainly, ye are the men. This is the same Jesus whom ye have crucified, whom ye with wicked hands have slain. Had not the application been so close, it's probable the success of the sermon had not been so considerable. Learn thence that the success and efficacy of the word preached depends upon a particular and warm application of it to every man's conscience. Generals will not affect. See an instance of it in what follows.